Hey, I'm Brother Taylor Lindemann, pastor at First Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Mississippi. We're so glad you joined us online today for this sermon. You can find additional sermons at these online sources. I hope that the sermon today speaks to you, and we pray that God will move through it.
At this time, we will be recognizing our graduates from kindergarten, from 8th grade, from 12th grade, and from college. Our first graduates are from kindergarten, and our first graduate is Maya Bird. Maya is graduating kindergarten at South Forest Attendance Center. Her parents are Joseph and Adrian Bird. Her hobbies include swimming, going to the park, playing with animals, and her clubs and honors include American Heritage Girls, Aggie Cheer Squad, and basketball. Maya Bird. Our second graduate is Abel DeLeo. Abel is graduating kindergarten at South Forest Attendance Center. His parents are Penny Hubble, and his grandparent is Ladine Hubble. His brother is Aiden DeLeo, and his hobbies include playing with Legos, swimming, and he is on the honor roll. Abel was not able to be with us today, but let's congratulate him with a round of applause. Our next kindergarten graduate is Lachlan Falvey. Lachlan is graduating kindergarten at Clear Creek Christian School. His parents are Katrina and Nolan Falvey. His grandparents are George and Doreen Norris. And his brother is Jason Cameron and his sister, Corbin Falvey. His hobbies include playing Nintendo Switch, dress up superhero, and he has all A's. Let's give a round of applause for Lachlan Falvey. Here, look at everybody. Go unwrap it and see. Our next graduate is Gia Isabella Hubble. Gia is graduating kindergarten at Ridgeway Elementary School. Her parent is Josh Hubble, and her grandparent is Ladine Hubble. Her brother and sister is Brooklyn and Jarek. Her hobbies include dance and playing with her brothers and sisters. Gia was unable to be with us today, but let's give her a congratulatory round of applause. Our next graduate of kindergarten is Melissa Johnson. Melissa is graduating kindergarten at South Forest Attendance Center. Her parents are Wendell Eugene and Heather Johnson. Her grandparent is Iris Weatherford, and her sister is Lillian Johnson. Her hobbies include dressing up, eating candy, face painting, makeup, and playing outside. She received the Kindest Student Award. Of a dad. Our next graduate from kindergarten is Jacob Frazier Poole. Jacob is graduating kindergarten at South Forest Attendance Center. His parents are Brandon and Jessica Archer. His grandmother is Ladine Hubble, and his brothers and sisters are James and Emma, Anna and Chandler. His hobbies include playing football, basketball, and hanging out with his best friends, James and Chandler. Jacob Frazier Poole. Our next graduates are graduating from 8th grade. Our first 8th grade graduate is Jason Cameron. Jason is an 8th grade graduate from Clear Creek Christian School. His parents are Katrina and Nolan Falvey. His grandparents are George and Doreen Norris. His hobbies include gaming, drawing, music, and he's the theater director and has all A's and B's. Jason Cameron. Our next 8th grade graduate is Abby Henderson. Abby is a graduate of 8th grade at South Forest Attendance Center. Her parents are Ronnie and Patricia Grotewald. Her grandmother is Lavanya Peavy and Gail Grotewald. Her hobbies include reading, writing, and watching videos, and she is in the honor band. Abby Henderson. Next, we will honor our 12th grade graduates. Graduating from 12th grade is Dakota Wayne Evans. Dakota is a graduate from Forest County AHS. His parents are Christina and Clifton Evans Jr. His grandparents are Wayne Clark, the late Evelyn Bryant, Cliff Evans Sr., and the late Etta Sue Evans. His brother and sister is Mitchell Eason and Amber Eason. His hobbies include hunting and fishing. And during his time in high school, he was a baseball player in 9th through 11th grade, basketball player in 9th through 11th grade, and football for 9th, 10th, and 12th grade. While he wasn't able to be with us this morning, let's give him a congratulatory round of applause. Next are graduates from college. Hunter Jerome is receiving a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering and is second lieutenant in the United States Military Academy at West Point, New York. His parents are Glenn and Tina Jerome, and his grandparents are Thomas and Juliet Jerome and Walter and Glenda Owen. His sisters are Michaela and Rachel Jerome. His hobbies include hunting, fly fishing, skeet, trap, snowboarding, boating, water sports, and his clubs and honors include Sandhurst Military Team, Fly Fishing Club, Skeet and Trap Team. While he wasn't able to be with us this morning, please give Hunter a round of applause. Our final graduate is Rachel Jerome. She is graduating with a Bachelor of Science in Nursing from the University of Alabama in Huntsville. Her parents are Glenn and Tina Jerome, and her grandparents are Thomas and Juliet Jerome, and Walter and Glenda Owen. Her brother and sister are Michaela Jerome and Hunter Jerome, and her clubs and honors include being a member of Delta Zeta, Sigma Theta Tan International Honor Society, and something that I cannot read. Let's congratulate Rachel, who is not able to be with us this morning, with a round of applause. We thank all of our graduates, and we look forward to seeing what you will do in the years ahead. If you know this song, feel free to sing along with us.
Lift your head, weary sinner. The river is just ahead. Down the path of forgiveness, salvation's waiting there. You've built a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Love is here to lift you up, here to lift you high. If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide.
Y'all gotta clap your hands or look happy or something.
All who've strayed and walked away, unspeakable things you've done. Fix your eyes on the mountain, let the past be dead and gone. Come on, ye saints and sinners, you can't outrun God. Whatever you've done can't overcome the power of the blood. If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. If you're lost and wrecked again, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. You know, there's people in here right now who wandered through that door, and you might be lost seeking for something in this life. You might be seeking to fulfill your life through the things that you can do. You might be seeking to be a good person. I've got news for you. We're all lost. We're all wandering until we come to a knowledge of Jesus Christ as our Savior. Amen? And so today I proclaim to you, there's nothing that you can do to be good enough. The work has already been done for you on the cross at Calvary. And so today, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today let that be the day that you no longer are lost. You're no longer wondering, but instead you have peace and a knowledge of somebody who has the power to save you today. Today, won't you make that the day that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior?
Lost and wondering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the world start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. If you're lost and wrecked again, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the world start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. Let the gates of glory open wide. Let the gates of glory open wide.
Luke chapter 15, and today we're going to be looking at a famous story in verses 11 through 32 of Luke chapter 15. He was always so smart. He worked so hard to get here. She's always been such a good girl. I bet her parents are proud. Congratulations, great job. I can't believe he made it this far. He was going to mess up eventually. I knew he'd never amount to anything. She got caught up with the wrong crowd. He just went down the wrong path. These are phrases that you hear at the end of a season of a life. At the end of a good season, you may hear some of those first phrases. But at the end of a bad one, you may hear some of the others. And today our graduates are exiting one season of life and entering into another. Today our kindergarten babies are finishing their first year of school. Our eighth graders are headed on to high school. Our seniors are headed to college or into the workforce. Today our college graduates are beginning adult life and their first days in their new professions. And today, each of those graduates have the opportunity to begin traveling on one of three distinct paths. Open your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 15 as we look at a very famous parable known as the parable of the prodigal son. Would you stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word? Hear now the words of the living and true God. And he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance in riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, and when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, Bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat, and be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again. He was lost, and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead, and is alive again, and was lost, and is found. In Luke chapter 15, we see one of Jesus' most famous parables, the parable of the prodigal son. And in this parable, we see three characters. We see a father and we see two sons. And it's very important that we don't just read the parable as a story about a father and two sons, but rather we understand who these are talking about. The father in our story, every reference to the father is a reference to God himself. And so when we read about the father, we should be thinking, this person is representing God the Father. And then we have two sons. One son is an unrighteous son. He does not obey his father. He does not respect. He does not love his father. And that could be any unrighteous person on the path of unrighteousness. And then the third person we see in the story is the righteous son, the son who is obedient to his father, who loves and respects his father and his own the righteous path. And we see the first son's character described in verses 11 through 13. Look back at your Bibles with me. In verse 11 it says, And he said, A certain man has two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. And there wasted his substance with riotous living. And so we see here the unrighteous son despises his father, even to the point his father's not dead, but he asks for his inheritance. How much do you have to hate your own father in order to say, I wish you were dead, give me what is mine already? And so this is what he does. And once he gets his inheritance, while his father is still living, we see in verse 13 that the son goes away from his father and even into a far country. Verse 13 says, But when thou makest, I'm on chapter 14, verse 13. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. He runs away. He goes far away from his father. And it shows us that he doesn't love him. And what does he do with the money that he gets? He spends it with, quote unquote, riotous, loose living. He spends it any way he wants. Anything his heart desires, that's what he does with his money. And so today, we have three paths. And the first path that we see is here. It's the path of the unrighteous. It's the path where we run from God, where we rebel from God, where we don't want anything to do with God. And each graduate here has a choice to make today. Which path are you going to take? And this first path, as you enter into high school, into college, into life, this path will tempt you with sin. And it will be very intense. It will be very tempting to see that opportunity to party, to drink, to live wild, to engage in what the world calls fun. And yet and still, the world will tempt us with that. And this temptation to live the unrighteous life of sin will be great. But this is not the only path that you can follow. Amen? Amen? On the other hand, there is the righteous son. The righteous son is also given an inheritance, but his character is much different from his brother. Look at verse 31. In verse 31 of chapter 15, we see this. It's the father saying to him, "And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine." The son who is on the righteous path, he stays very close to the father throughout the story. And as a result, this is the proclamation that the father gives him. This son is always with the father, and it represents that this son is loved by and in return loves his father. This son also has access to everything that the father has. And as a result of his obedience, this son's every need is met by the father. We see the unrighteous son, he leads down an unrighteous path. And here we see our second path with the righteous son. The righteous son shows us the righteous path for every person that would walk this life. A person who at a very young age would trust in Jesus and stick to that good path. This path is paved by those people who honor God's word, who obey his commands, who read their Bibles, who attend church, who do all of the things that God has asked of them. You have the unrighteous path, and you have the righteous path. And so today, my plea to everyone, but especially our graduates, as you head into this next stage of life, keep God first. Obey his commands. Read your Bible. Continue to attend church. Surround yourself with godly people. And as a result, you will have a life that is blessed by God. Amen? Amen. Follow after the obedient son. Follow after the path of righteousness. Because the path of righteousness, it leads to good things. But the path of unrighteousness leads to peril. Let's look at these next verses in our passage as we see where this unrighteous path leads us. Look again at verses 14 through 17. "And thou shalt be blessed." I keep going back to chapter 14, y'all. You're going to have to tell me to stop looking at that page. All right, verse 14 and chapter 15. "And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks of that swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? Once the son runs out of money, he runs into trouble. I had a Sunday school teacher growing up, and she would always repeat this phrase, that sin will take you further than you want to go. It'll keep you longer than you want to stay, and it'll make you pay more than you're willing to pay. When you head down the road of unrighteousness, it leads to consequences that the world didn't tell you was there. The unrighteous path leads to things just like we see happening to this son. And in verse 14, we see that that path that he followed, he thought would fulfill his desires, but ultimately it didn't. Look back at verse 14. Verse 14 says, "And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want." Sin does not fulfill. Instead, sin leaves us with this void inside of us that the world tells us, cram full of more stuff. You don't have enough stuff. You don't have enough fun. You don't do enough ungodly things. You don't sin enough. Come and do more. And it'll fill that void inside of you. Yet we follow that unrighteous path and we go further and deeper into sin, and it still leaves us wanting. The son, he had all that he desired. He had his father's inheritance. He spent it however he wanted. A child's dream. Maybe some of our dreams today. And look where it led him. It led him to want more. Sin leaves us with a void that stuff can never fill. Amen? Amen. Next, we see that it not only didn't fulfill him, but that path led him to a place he had no business being. Verse 15. "And he went and joined himself to a city of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine." This parable is told to a Jewish audience, and for Jews, swine, pigs, are unclean. And so this young man, he finds himself out of options. The only thing that he can do is do the filthiest, nastiest, most unclean job that was offered to him. This path led him to a place where his parents would be ashamed of what he was doing. This path led him to a place where people, maybe from his home church, would look at him and say, "What has he gotten himself into?" But it goes further than that, because when we look in verse 16, it goes even further. It says, "And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine ate, and no man would give to him." Not only was he keeping after this unclean animal, but he was also wanting to eat the food that was given to this unclean animal. He was not only in a place he shouldn't have been, but he was lowering himself far below even that. He not only looked after, but he ate after the pigs. The unrighteous path doesn't fulfill. It leads us to places where we ought not be. And finally, it takes us far from the love that he had received had he just stayed near God. Verse 17 says, "And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger?'" As he looks back, he had got the inheritance. He had gotten all that he needed, but he had wasted it to the point that even his father's servants were better off than him. Sin had taken him rock bottom. And to my graduates and even to my congregation today, I warn you that following the unrighteous path, while the world will say it's wonderful, while the world will tempt you with everything that it has to offer, ultimately it will disappoint. It will leave you broken. It will leave you hurting. It will leave you trying to fill a void that only one thing can fill. And the unrighteous path will not only disappoint, but it will take you to places you have no business going. It will take you into drunkenness. It will take you into drugs. It will take you into ungodly relationships. But worse than any earthly place that this unrighteous path might take you, the unrighteous path leads us on a path straight to hell. Amen? And so today, if you are on that right unrighteous path, it will take you to the very bottom of the barrel. It will take you to utter darkness. It will take you to a place where eternal fires burn and there is gnashing of teeth. Today, the world would tell you, "Come and have fun. Follow me down the unrighteous path." But I'm telling you to steer clear of it, because it leads to a hell where the very presence of God is absent. And you might not understand this, but the thing that frightens me the most about hell is none of the things that I just mentioned. The fire is scary, yes. The gnashing of teeth is scary, yes. All of these things, the utter darkness is scary, yes. But so much scarier than that is the absence of the real presence of God. A presence that you might not know you're feeling in this life, but every good thing comes from this presence. Imagine a place where when you call out to God, he doesn't want to hear you. You have chosen your path. Imagine a place where it's just sorrow and sadness and wrath forever. This is the place called hell, and it is the destination at the end of this path of unrighteousness. Today I'm calling you, if you're on that path of unrighteousness, to get off of it. Because there is a righteous path and there is an unrighteous path, but there is a third path that we see in our text today. Look with me at verses 18 through 24. The boy says, "I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants.' And he arose and he came to his father. And he was yet a great way off. His father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Even though the boy had made some mistakes, even though the boy had hated his father, even though the boy had ended up as far from God as he could get, there was a third path. It was the path back home. And today you may be on the road of unrighteousness, but I want to tell you that just over the hill, just on the side of the road, there's a third path there. There's a path there that was made just for you. There's a path there that was paved by nail-scarred hands. There's a path there that is covered with the precious blood. There is a path there today, church. I want you to know that no matter how far down the unrighteous path you are, no matter how deep in sin you may be, there is a path, and it leads straight to the foot of the cross. There is a path that plunges you beneath the crimson flood. There is a path, and it leads to someone named Jesus. Amen. No one is too far gone to take the third path, to take the path of redemption today. And we see how the Son accesses the third path in verses 18 and 19. First, he says, I will arise and go to my Father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned before heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of your hired servants. The first thing the Son does to head down the third path is he recognizes his sins. He recognizes the wretched sinner that he is, and he turns away from the path of unrighteousness, and he turns back toward the Father and asks the Father for forgiveness. And today I want you to know, if you're on the path to unrighteousness, if you need a third path today, Christ is just but a prayer away. Today, look over your life. See how wretched you are. See the multitude of sins that are in your life. See that if you continue down that unrighteous path, that hell is at the end. We're all broken, sinful people in need of a Savior, each and every one of us in this congregation today. But we first have to see our sins and repent and turn away from them, and then run as fast as you can to a Father who will forgive you. And what happens when he runs to the Father for forgiveness? Verse 20. Verse 20 says, and he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. We would expect a God who hates sin to condemn us, to punish us, to hate us when we return to his face. But before the boy can even say, I'm sorry, Dad, forgive me, God in his great grace, in his rich mercy, runs out first. And today, if you're on the path of unrighteousness, if you would but repent and turn from your sins and run to the Father in forgiveness, he would receive you before you even arrived. God loves us that much. And when you turn to the Lord in forgiveness, he will love you and shower you with that love. When we turn to the Lord, we experience true forgiveness. But that's not all the Father does. Look what he does next for the boy in verses 21 through 24. And the Son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. When we return to God in forgiveness, we become one of his children. And the first thing that we see the father do is he puts the robe, the ring, the shoes, and he kills the fatted calf, all for his son. When we turn to Jesus, there are benefits, there are blessings of peace, of love, of comfort, of eternal life that he showers upon us when we return to him. And so many people, I think maybe one of the only hang-ups of their faith is, if I turn to Jesus, everybody's going to know I'm a fraud. Everybody's going to know whether I'm 7 or 70, everybody who walks down this aisle has trouble. But look what happens in verse 23 at the end. When the boy comes home, it says, and let us eat and be merry. And in verse 24 at the end, it says, and they began to be merry. When a sinner walks down the aisle and turns off of the unrighteous path and takes the path of redemption, the congregation is merry. People are happy. And if we look back at the parable just before this in chapter 15, verse 10, it tells us that even the angels in heaven rejoice when someone turns to Jesus. Don't be afraid to walk down this aisle, no matter how old, no matter how young, no matter how sinful you may be. We will be merry. Angels in heaven will be merry when you come. But the greatest gift of all is that when we return to God for forgiveness, that loving relationship between God and man is restored. And right now, if you're on that unrighteous path, I want you to know, if you're on the unrighteous path, that there is tension between you and God. You are rebelling against Him. You are hating His law. You are disrespecting a holy and righteous God. There's tension between you and God if you're on the unrighteous path. But I want you to know, if you take the third path, the path of redemption, if you turn to Jesus today, there'll be forgiveness. There'll no longer be tension, but your relationship with God will be restored. God created you so that you might know, and that means He might show you His love. God created you so that you could worship Him rightly and understand how great He is. And today, if you don't know Christ, I'm asking that you turn from your sins, turn to forgiveness, turn toward a restored relationship with God. As Cliff comes today, I'm urging our graduates to take the righteous path. Stay close to God and you will live a life of blessings as you pursue your relationship with Him. But for the rest of us, I wonder today what path you might be on. Today you might be on the unrighteous path. You might be running from God. You might be rebelling against Him. But today I want you to know there's a third path. And no matter how far gone you think you are, no matter how far outside of forgiveness you think you are, no matter the sins that you've done, today I want you to know that there's a third path and it leads home. It's the path of redemption and it's open for all who would ask for forgiveness. Today, whatever path you're on, I'm asking that you come. Today, we have the privilege of baptizing Joseph Byrd, Jr. into the family of God. Joey came two or three weeks ago and told me of his profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And I shared with you last week that sweet moment when Adrian was tied up talking. And he saw that opportunity to come and talk to me. And he ran up to me and said, "Brother Taylor, I want to get baptized." He's eager, and according to his profession, and according to our counseling that mom and dad and I did, we know that he is truly saved and ready to pursue a relationship with Jesus. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you, Joey Byrd, Jr., in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of His death, and raised to walk in the newness of life. A few weeks before Joey, his brother Gabe came to me and said, "I've accepted Jesus into my heart, and I want to be baptized into the family of God." And so, along the same timeline as his brother, we went through baptismal counseling, and it was assured of everyone in the room that Gabe, too, understood what it meant to be a Christian, and that he wanted to follow through with baptism as he professed Christ as his Lord and Savior. And so, Gabriel Byrd, upon your profession of faith as Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, and raised to walk in the newness of life. We're so happy for both of these boys. We're going to have our benediction and our offertory prayer, and then we'll stand and sing the family of God. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful day that we've had in your house. We thank you for these two boys' profession of faith, and Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit might guide them in the days ahead as they seek to honor you with their lives. Lord, we pray, thanking you for your word, and we pray if there's anyone here today who by the message, by the songs, by this profession of faith and obedience and baptism, if they might not know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, that they might get on the path of righteousness through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you bless these tithes and offerings as we receive them and keep us as we leave your house and come back. We ask this in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us online today. Remember, you can find additional videos at these online locations. If you would like to give, you can mail your offering to First Baptist Church Brooklyn at P.O. Box 340 in Brooklyn, Mississippi 39425. If you would like to talk to someone, you can call our church number or you can visit us for one of our in-person worship times. We hope to see you soon.